Hey there, amazing audience who have joined the Revolving Time today. Get ready to embark on an unforgettable adventure with us. Subscribe now and let's uncover the hidden secrets and truths together. Today, we're diving into a topic that's tough, but one that each and every one of us might encounter on our journey, dealing with deceit and betrayal. Well, my friends, today's story is published by DG here. My marriage life was always in turmoil, so I took one wrong step and it cost me 25 years of my life. Well, let the story begin and I hope you enjoy it. Here it is, the afternoon of Christmas evening, and I am sitting all alone at my kitchen table with a bottle of Jim Beam in my gun. I'm not a big drinking man, but I did get the Jim Beam whiskey to build up my courage to do what I'm about to do. You see, this is the first Christmas I would be spending by myself in my 64 years of life. My wife of 42 years died 3 months ago, leaving me alone. Not everyone has happy holidays. I can see that now. It's not that my marriage was all that good. We had some really good times and then those really bad times. I'm just sitting here reminiscing. I remember when I first met my wife Sophie. She and her younger sister Helen were at the malt shop when I walked in. I was just a cocky guy who liked to meet young ladies and give them my spiel. I walked up to Sophie and gave her just about every pickup line I ever learned. She looked at me and said, "George, you're so full of SHT, I can't believe it," as she smiled. "Does that mean you'll go out with me then?" I asked. She just smiled and said she would think about it. That's how we first met. On our first real date, we went to the drive-in movie. I did my best work at the drive-in. We kissed and played around a little and then I started falling for her big time. About a year later, we got married. I remember her sister Helen came up to me at the reception and said, "George, I have to tell you something. When you first came up to me and Sophie at the malt shop, we both liked you." Then Sophie looked at me and said, "I'm going to marry that man someday, just like that George." She knew what she wanted and went after it. It surprised me that both girls liked me and that Sophie was so sure about us. But that's the way she always was. She really was a special woman. Update: our love life was fantastic when we first got married. We were like two rabbits making love all the time. It was special. It wasn't just love or just love. It's hard to explain, but it was loving fun. We did it most anytime, any place, and everywhere. We would always try new places to make love. We ended up having two kids, a boy and a girl. Sophie was a great mother and then a great grandmother. She put love into everything she did. I remember when the kids were just little, maybe 7 or 8. They wanted to decorate the Christmas tree. Well, Sophie was somewhat of an artist or perfectionist when it came to decorating. I couldn't imagine her letting the kids decorate the tree. I just set the tree up and left the rest to Sophie and the kids. She let them put on the decorations. She tried to explain about decorating but let the kids go and do it their way. They were happy as can be when they got done. The tree looked like a disaster. She just smiled at the kids, told them they had done a great job, and then put them to bed. Then she came back in and redecorated the whole tree for the next 2 hours. When the kids got up the next morning, they looked at the tree and asked what happened. Sophie just said she added a few decorations. The kids looked at her and said, "We did good, Mom, didn't we?" "Yes, you did. You did a great job," was her reply. That's just the way she was. She put love into everything. There was nothing she couldn't cook. We hardly ever worried about leftovers at our house. Everyone always ate everything up. Even if she just made a sandwich, it was always better than the one I made and used exactly the same stuff. I remember asking her one time, "Why do your sandwiches taste better? It doesn't make sense. We use the same stuff." She looked at me, smiled and said, "I always put love in my sandwiches." It was true. Everything she did was just a little better. Making love with Sophie was incredible. Of course, after the birth of the kids, we did it a lot less, but we still had the loving fun. That was until I ruined it. I don't remember if Sophie was going through a change or sick, but she became a little distant to me. Now, looking back, I believe it was the medication she was on. Anyway, I had an affair. This gal at work was kind of flaunting her wares. Her husband was incarcerated, and she must have been lonely. I went for it. Seeing Sophie was kind of turned off to me, I went after Nancy. We probably had love a dozen times over a few months period. I would be lying if I said it wasn't any good. It was great. It was new, strange, and different. I just fell to the temptation. Of course, one day Sophie found out and I figured my marriage was over. I did the usual apologizing and explaining about it not meaning anything, promising to stop and never do it again. Sophie yelled and screamed at me. The worst thing she did was cry. I couldn't stand to see her cry. That's when I hit my lowest level ever. Seeing what it did to her just tore me apart. She didn't deserve it. She should have just dumped me right then, but she didn't. She stayed with me. Our life never returned to the happy state we had before the affair. I know Sophie never trusted me again, even to the day she died, which was 20 plus years later. We didn't make love till a few months after the affair. We had gone to a party, and when we came home, Sophie let me make love to her. It was never the same. We had love, but it wasn't love anymore. Sophie never gave so freely of herself again. Every once in a while I'd feel her giving some, but never the happy-go-lucky fun-loving that we once shared. It was my fault. There was nothing I could do to repair the damage I had done. The rest of our life went on pretty normal. The loving meals, the happy mom, and a lot of good times. We enjoyed our vacations and doing things together, but the love life eventually deteriorated into nothing. There was a time there when Sophie said she didn't care for love all that much, that she learned to live without it, and so it wasn't a big thing in her life anymore. That is enough to turn any husband off. It was even hard to get a hard-on when the woman you loved didn't want to make love with you anymore. I remember reading a story on communicating. Sophie and I did that. We communicated. The only problem was our talks always ended up in arguments. It was almost always negative talk about me. I didn't do enough around the house. I didn't want to take her shopping. I spent too much time on the computer. I never wanted to go anywhere. And on and on and on. Update 1. About 5 years ago, I had a heart-to-heart talk with Sophie. I told her that I don't think she ever forgave me for the affair, that I believe she fell out of love with me and I deserved it. I believe she only stayed with me because of the kids and that our life outside of no love was pretty good. I still loved her and told her I never had love with any woman since the affair over 20 years ago. I promised her that I would always be there for her, and if she wanted me, all she had to do was ask. I went to her one time after that and even tried love on her. She said she didn't really feel anything. I touched her, but there were no sensations. After that, we cuddled once in a while, but that was it. One day she said she knew I did. I asked her what choices did I have. She didn't want to have love with me. I promised her never to cheat on her again and was going to keep that promise. I would never hurt her again. She just walked away. I was now thinking about my kids. Of course, they weren't kids anymore. They would soon have grandchildren of their own. George Jr. lives a state away with his wife and 3 kids. Dorothy lived maybe 100 miles away with her husband and 2 kids. It really hurt Sophie when their jobs took them away. At least their children were pretty much grown by then. Sophie just loved being around the kids. All the Christmases when our kids were little were the best. Christmas morning we all sat around and opened presents. The smile on their faces and the smile that Sophie had just watching them. Some of our joyous times were around the kids during the holidays. Then after our kids were grown and married, Sophie did the same thing with the grandchildren. The warmth and smiles that were on the little faces was her reward. When the kids had to move away, Sophie made sure we went to their houses for Christmas. She wasn't about to miss the holidays with family. I just went along and enjoyed the holidays. If it made Sophie happy, I was happy. Sophie's sister Helen got married a few years after us. She married an insurance guy named Ted. They seemed to be a pretty good match. The 4 of us went everywhere together. We were almost inseparable. We went to the movies, dancing, dinner all the time, and even went on a cruise together. I probably loved Helen almost as much as Sophie. I never did anything to harm our relationship in any way. The 4 of us just seemed to hit it off. I know Sophie thought a lot of Ted also. But we all just stayed friends, that is, except Sophie and Helen. They were probably as close as 2 sisters could get. I doubt if they even kept a secret from one another. 3 years ago, Ted had a heart attack and passed away. He was only 57 years old. Way too young to die. Helen was heartbroken. She lost her love. Sophie and Helen both took it really hard. We were 4, now we were 3. We still included Helen in most everything we did. At least I didn't have to go shopping all the time now. Helen went on with her life. Since Ted was an insurance agent, he saw to it that she was well taken care of. At least financially, she was secure. She had 1 daughter who lived in California. She spent the holiday season out there with her daughter and her family. She was never in a hurry to get back, so she stayed usually a month or so. She was planning on going again this year. Wish she would have stayed home this year. Maybe she could talk me out of what I was about to do. There was always turmoil surrounding our marriage. Everything seems to always lead us back to the affair. Do-overs. That's when, if you had the chance, you could go back and correct the mistakes in your life. Would-a, should-a, could-a, doesn't mean a damn thing. I made the mistakes and now spent the last 25 years of my life paying for it. I thought of leaving Sophie 12 times. The problem was that I caused the heartache. I had the affair. I'm the one who put our marriage in this lifelong turmoil. But most of all, I still had strong feelings for Sophie. Even if we had arguments, which was pretty regular, I knew she was always there. We might have even been in different rooms, but I didn't miss her. I knew she was just 2 rooms away. It's funny when you think about it. Sometimes it was like 2 strangers living in the same house. But it felt secure. We pretty much learned to live with each other's faults. Update 2. Damn, I wish I was a writer so I could tell you how it really feels to miss someone. I just don't know the words. Ache, pain, misery, loneliness, that's what I've been feeling since Sophie's death. I don't want to be here alone anymore. It's terrible, no one to even argue with. I go out during the day, always coming home to an empty, lonely, dark, too quiet place. I don't even know my own thoughts anymore. How do you cry on paper? How do you explain emptiness? Sophie was right when she told me one time that I should die first, that I didn't know how to take care of myself well enough to live alone and that I probably couldn't handle it. I remember arguing with her that I took care of myself for over 60 years and I could continue to do so until the day I die. She just laughed and said, George, I'm the one who has taken care of you for the last 42 years. I think God made me your guardian angel because you can't go through life alone. Looking back, I believe she was right. I hate to admit it, but I don't do well on my own. But now I'm just too old and too tired to go looking for a partner. The only person that would even come close is Helen, and I doubt if she would want anything to do with me, not after she was through talking to Sophie, and besides, by now she's probably 1,000 miles away. I know I'm feeling sorry for myself, but I'm in this terrible rut and can't or maybe don't want to take the effort to climb out of it. I'll just keep drinking my Jim Beam and build up some courage. Looking back on the last 6 months of our life together is painful. One day she wasn't feeling good. I suggested she go to the doctor, and we argued about it as usual. Finally, she decided to go. I drove her to the doctor's office and he ran a bunch of tests. She came out of the office and hugged me. Right then I knew we had problems. I can't tell you the last time she came and hugged me like that. We both went back into the doctor's private office where he told us the bad news. She had tumors and they were probably cancerous. He was still going to run some tests, but because of past experiences, he was almost sure of his diagnosis. He asked us to come back in 3 days and he could verify the facts. We went back 3 days later, and he said she had the late stages of cancer. There was nothing he could do. He would put her on chemo for a while, but the outlook was very grave. At most, he gave her 6 months to live. I just broke down and bawled. I took her in my arms and she was the strong one. She said everything would be all right. How can everything be all right when my wife is dying? When we got home, she called Helen. She came right over and they cried together. I wanted to do everything I could for my wife in her last months. Always too late, would I, could I, should I? There were no second chances here. During her last months, Helen and I did everything we could to make Sophie comfortable. It should have been me, not Sophie, who was dying. We called the kids and they came down to see her as often as they could. It was really a strain on everyone. Trying to put on a happy face when talking to Sophie and crying all other times. In her last days while in the hospital, she spoke to everyone in the family alone. She had private thoughts for each person. I remember her talking to me. I stayed by her side pretty much continually. Realizing she was dying and being with her knowing there was absolutely nothing I could do was the most inadequate feeling a person could have. Looking at her lying there knowing anytime she might breathe her last breath. One of the last things she said to me was, George, keep your eye on Helen for me. I always worried about her. That was Sophie, dying and worrying about others. Then she looked at me as I held her hands with tears running down my face and said, George, I forgive you and I have always loved you. So please forgive me for not being the wife you wanted. Then she closed her eyes and went to sleep. About an hour later, she stopped breathing. As I walked out of her room, my family were all standing there. They saw me crying and knew it was over. Their mother, grandmother, and sister had passed away. Everyone was in tears, especially me. God gives us one life to make the best of, and I felt I ruined hers. Why, Lord, why take her? Why didn't you take me instead? I don't want to be alone. I want my wife back. I don't care if we argued every day. I don't care what she calls me. I just wish I could make up for the pain I caused her. Please, Lord, just give her back to me. But it was not to be. That only happens in fairy tales, and this was real life. I sat at the table taking another shot of Jim Beam, tears just rolling down my cheeks. I was so lonely. It had only been 3 months and felt like years. I couldn't live like this. I recalled Thanksgiving just last month. The kids didn't want me to be alone, so I made the trip to be with George Jr. and his family. My daughter Dorothy came with her family so we could enjoy Thanksgiving together. It wasn't a happy occasion for me at all. I didn't feel thankful. And I knew it built tension with the kids. There they were with their families trying to enjoy the holidays. Of course they missed their mother, but as they said, life goes on, Dad. They invited me up for Christmas, but I wasn't going to ruin that holiday for them also. They were able to get on with their lives. I was the lonely old guy that I felt was just in the way. I hoped they would understand what I was doing. I didn't want to be alone anymore. Final update. I spent the last 3 months getting my affairs in order. I didn't want to burden my kids with any undue expenses. I had everything in order, insurances, taxes, wills. All I needed now was courage. Hopefully Jim Beam would help me with that. I had a housekeeper who came in twice a week to help keep the place clean. I didn't dirty it much. I didn't spend that much time at home. I ate out most of the time now and just sat in the park feeding the ducks. You've seen the lonely man just sitting there at the park. That was me. Then at dark I come back home to this big lonely place. The only happiness was when Helen came by to help me sort out and take care of Sophie's belongings. I gave her most of Sophie's stuff. I knew she would want her to have it. I did let my daughter Dorothy take whatever she wanted of her mom's belongings first. One day when Helen was here and we were sorting out Sophie's stuff, I gave her a hug. She felt so good. Then I went to kiss her. I know I shouldn't have, but I was just lonely. The last thing I wanted to do was alienate Helen. She looked at me with tears in her eyes and said, "No, George, not now." I let go of her and went to the bathroom and just cried. When I came back out of the bathroom, she was gone. That was a few days ago and the last time she stopped by. I poured myself another shot. The courage was coming. I drank it down when there was a knock at the door. Who the HLL's bothering me now? I got up and opened the door and there stood Helen. Immediately tears welled up in my eyes. I was an old guy. Tears flow pretty easy out of us and we can't seem to stop them even if we want to. Other than Sophie, she was the prettiest sight I could imagine at that moment. "Well, George, are you going to invite me in or do I have to stand out here?" I apologized and opened the door. I had to hug her. I couldn't help it. Us old guys are like that. I said, "I thought you were going to go be with your daughter for the holidays." She said, "I called my daughter and told her I wasn't going to be coming this year. I'm going to spend the holidays with a friend." I felt like I was just imposing on my daughter and her family, and I wasn't really comfortable being there for such a long time. I asked her, "What friend are you going to visit and spend the holidays with?" She laughed just like Sophie used to and said, "You, George, you're the friend I want to spend the holidays with if you will have me. I know I'm not Sophie and I'm an older woman, but I'm lonely too, George." I started crying and started apologizing for my actions the last time she came to visit. Of course I wanted her here. I couldn't think of anyone alive that I wanted more to be with. To say she was beautiful or gorgeous would seem funny to people since she was 59 years old, but to me she was. She looked great for her age. She said, "Don't apologize, George. I wanted you to kiss me, but I needed to think things out and have a talk with you first." I took her coat and asked her to sit down. I remembered the gun on the table. I quickly took it and put in the drawer. When I turned around, Helen was standing there. She didn't see the gun, but the Jim Beam was still there. She looked at me and said, "Would you like some coffee, George?" She then took the Jim Beam, put it in the cupboard and started making coffee. God, it felt so good just having her here. She looked at me and said, "George, if we are going to enjoy the holidays, don't we need a little decorations?" As she smiled at me, I headed downstairs to get our little tree and decorations. Together Helen and I set up the little tree and put on some Christmas music. Then she said she would be right back. She went out to the car and brought me in a little present and set it under the tree. I went into my bedroom and brought out a gift I had bought for her. I had stopped at the store a couple of weeks ago to get the kids each gift certificates for their families. While I was there, I bought a necklace for Helen and had it gift wrapped. I was going to give it to her the day she left. I put it under our little tree next to the present she bought me. Then she began to explain things to me. "George, you know that I have always cared for you. Sophie knew it, too. You know how close Sophie and I were. She loved you, George, she loved you deeply. You also know that she never really forgave you for the affair until her last days." "Yes, George, I know all about the affair. She told me you tried everything to make it up to her, but she just couldn't let it go. I told her many times to let it go, but she just said she couldn't. I loved my husband, George. Ted was a wonderful man. We had a wonderful life together. I'll always remember him. He'll always be in my heart just like Sophie will always be in yours. But, George, I have always loved you too. I know you knew it, but you belong to Sophie. You know that Sophie talked to everyone before her death. George, Sophie was worried about you. She said she didn't know if you could make it through life alone. The last thing she said to me was, 'Helen, take care of my George. I know he loves you, too. He's a good man, but I'm afraid he won't make it on his own. He needs plenty of love and attention. He's stubborn as an ox and won't listen to you. But he is a wonderful man and you need him, too, Helen.'" I was crying again. Damn, grown men aren't supposed to cry, and that's about all I do anymore. I looked at Helen and said, "Sophie was right, you know. I've always had feelings for you. Other than Sophie, you're the only person I truly care for," as I gave her a hug. I then asked Helen how long she was going to stay. We could go get something to eat and come back and open our gifts. We both laughed, knowing there was only one present apiece under the tree. Then it happened. Helen looked at me and said, "George, I'll stay forever if you'll have me." Tears again as I kissed her. I told her that was fine with me. Sophie was right. She was my guardian angel. Thanks for watching. Remember, Revolving Time exists because of your support. So take care of yourself and see you soon with another story.